Are you there? Can we start the session, please?
You are asking me.
Am I audible? Yeah.
Yes, yes, you are. Yes, I'm here.
Firstly and the foremost, I would request all the participants other than the speaker, Mr. Sachin Sharma, to please keep your audio on mute so that we do not have disturbances during the webinar. And a very, very warm welcome to all the participants for attending this very interesting webinar on creating ownership and responsibilities and how do you develop a learning culture among employees. And today we have an expert faculty, Mr. Sachin Sharma. Before I go and introduce him about his credentials, I would just like to brief about today's session. But before we go to today's session, I would like to inform everybody and wish everybody that this week is the Energy Conservation Week, which we are all are celebrating, and with a pledge to conserve the energy and also to reduce the cost towards energy. With this note, we shall start today's webinar on how do we develop a learning culture. So speaking about learning culture, we probably will break the two terms, the learning and culture. And we will try to understand first what is culture. Speaking in layman's term, when we speak about culture, it's basically deriving your own values, your own beliefs, your own processes and your conventions. And based on that, the culture of a family or the culture of an organization is derived. And when this culture is derived, once we add a learning factor to it and we encourage a learning agenda to this culture, then it becomes of a learning culture. And the most important responsible person to imbibe this learning culture or entrust this learning culture is the leaders of our organizations. And this can be developed by having a formal plan of training, giving identification for the employees who have attended the training and different ways to kind of develop this learning culture. And once this learning culture is developed, it is very essential because in today's times, if you see the businesses at every minute or every second is changing. And this is because of the digital technology. And if one has to keep abreast with the newest technology, it is very essential to keep updated with the knowledge or the recent know-hows. Hence, learning culture is very important. And it is known, it's a very known fact that businesses grow or businesses excel or employees excel in those organizations which has a culture of learning. And we are very fortunate that we belong to our organization, Rashtra Chemicals and Fertilizer, who has taken keen interest in having a learning culture and ensuring that all employees at all stages, right from the inception of an employee to the time the employee leaves the organization and to ensure that they go to the different levels in the organization, learning is being imparted to all the employees. Now, once this learning culture is established, we next move down to the ownership. So ownership is nothing but having a team of motivated people. If you find the difference between accountability and ownership is accountability is giving a task, whereas ownership is being responsible for the task. So once these two are established, I think the learning culture is going to be much more essential, or it probably will be established. And the one most important factor is having or creating ownership is not getting into the micromanagement and also having trust among employees. So today we have a very important speaker or a facilitator who is basically an international coach. He will guide us through this journey of how we can have or adapt to a learning culture. And to adapt to a learning culture, how accountability, ownership, and responsibility helps in coming to this learning culture. So giving this is a brief about today's topic. And then today I'm here to introduce our faculty. And Mr. Sachin Sharma, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. In spite of your busy schedule and you've been touring the complete globe, going through a resume, it's very interesting to have an international speaker at this forum. So Mr. Sharma is one of an international coach, a world one laser coach for executives and senior leaders, who uses the emotional intelligence and mindfulness. He's basically based at Sydney, Australia, from last two decades. Sachin is passionate about mindfulness and emotional intelligence. He's created an organizational culture development framework called Invisible Leadership. He addresses complex corporate challenges by application of mindfulness and emotional intelligence. Challenges such as high attrition, low retention, office politics, diversity and inclusion, gender inequality, bullying and harassment, low employee engagement, good to great leadership journey. And this is his forte in the human resource management or the kind of OD interventions. And his team at Wooji International is passionate about solving such challenges mindfully. So we look forward for hearing to you, Mr. Sharma, on this very interesting topic. And once again, welcome to RCF.
Thank you. Thank you, Rupali. Thank you for that great introduction. And also, you've really summarized the topic today very well in terms of how you define what is ownership, what is responsibility, what is learning culture. So that was a good summary up front. So I believe that now the job is to elaborate it over the next 90 minutes or so.
Yes.
So thank you for that. I am also accompanied by my business partner, Ambika. So she's the one who has developed this invisible leadership that we talk about. We both created this together. And I would like her to jump in wherever is required and provide her inputs. So one of the things is that she comes from a very different kind of a stream, different experience altogether as well, which complements very well what we are doing. So Ambika, please feel free to do that. And she also does a very good job keeping me on time also, because once I start talking, then sometimes I lose track. And she's very good at that also. So Ambika, just feel free to jump in wherever. So should I put up my presentation now?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
Okay. Is this visible?
Yeah, it's visible. At least someone on unmuted. Yeah, go ahead.
All right. So as the topic is quite clear for today, it's creating ownership and responsibility with learning culture among employees. So there's a lot in this topic to go through over next about an hour or so I'll cover, and then we'll leave some time for question and answers also. So hopefully we'll cover the whole thing in time. Let's see. Now I have mentioned invisible leadership for HR and business leaders, because these concepts that we are going to share with you is part of the invisible leadership framework that we have developed. So everything that we do ultimately links back to this organization culture development framework called invisible leadership. We have developed this over the last 3 years and it keeps refining. It's not like a done job. It is based on emotional intelligence and mindfulness. And every time we do something, we learn something new. Our own understanding improves about something. Then we bring it back into invisible leadership framework also. So it's a living, breathing framework. It keeps changing also, and it keeps us guided, whatever we do. So this is where you will see the concepts that we are sharing apart from that framework. So let's move ahead. Let's first talk about ownership and responsibility. We covered that part. We are talking about creating ownership and responsibility. From my corporate experience and talking to HR, I have good network of HR people that we are connected to. When we speak to them, one of the things which we have heard, which actually led us to create invisible leadership framework to begin with, is this constant complaint from business leaders and managers that people don't take enough ownership and responsibility. We hear that a lot. And that actually became the bottom line for us to start working on invisible leadership. Now, we know this, but it's important that we understand how big this problem can actually be. Just lack of ownership and responsibility is something which you see at the top. But then there are other things which you see which you may not realize that how this is linked to lack of ownership and responsibility. So problems like mentioned office politics, high attrition, low retention, gender inequality, low diversity and inclusion, bullying and harassment, and ultimately low employee engagement. These are some of the problems. I'm not really listed all the problems that could link, but these are some of the high problems that often corporate world faces. And they may see these things as individual. That what is the link between office politics and let's say gender inequality or things like that. So you might see these things as different problems. And what we often say is, let's not try to fix the fruit. Let's fix the root. You see a bad fruit and you start doing something. You see a lot of office politics and you start to do something about office politics. You see low employee engagement and you start to do something about low employee engagement. You would create programs or whatever to engage employees. That is fixing the fruit. That is putting some kind of pesticide or whatever on the fruit. Now, that might treat the fruit temporarily, but because the roots are faulty, another bad fruit will grow back. So it's not going to be a permanent cure. So instead of that, let's go to the root and fix it. And exactly what is the root that we are trying to fix? And that is what we call the culture. As Rupali also mentioned, the culture of the company is the root. If the culture is not conducive, it's not very good, then it creates many different problems going forward. So rather than tackling those individual problems, let's look at, put some time and efforts into diagnosing the problems in the culture and fix that.
And so there's an example that we'd like to share here. Like I'm right now in midst of mountains and I was looking at someone. So when they don't have a bad, if they don't have a good crop, they don't really fix the crop. They don't put pesticides here. They start treating the soil. That is how I understood that, you know, that that culture is basically the soil. And these things that we see are nothing but bad crops. So usually a farmer would go and just pick some pesticides and put it. But in the mountains, which is actually the ancient way of doing agriculture, they start treating the soil and clearing up the air. And I think that is what we are talking about. So treating the soil, going to the sustainable part of it, really fixing the roots of things.
And then it fixes more problems than just one. So that is the, the benefit. That is the benefit of it, that you have better return on investment of your efforts, of the money, the energy that you're putting in, better return on investment because you're not just fixing one or two problems. You are fixing multiple problems that may have looked very different to begin with. You may not have connected them, but once you have fixed this, they start fixing by itself as well. And then you see the link that, okay, this also got solved. Yeah. So that was a good example. And we all know this also. So that so one of the beauty of this example is that we can all relate to it. We know this. So bringing it to the forefront of our mind and imagining this is happening, it tells you that it works. This is how it is. Life works like this. And we've all seen it. So why not bring this to our organization also? So moving to the next part is, so what do we do? How do we design a learning culture in a way to address these issues? So now we know how big this problem is and we know that we need to go to the root. So let's now look at some strategy, some way of what exactly we need to do. How do we design before we just start jumping into doing something? Now we need to take a few steps back and start to plan, start to strategize and think clearly. So here are some of the things which I would talk about today is design considerations when you are thinking of introducing or even improving the learning culture in your organization. And then I will also share an example of how we have done it. So that will make it even more clear, even more relatable to you that what exactly I'm taking. I'm not just going to leave you at a plan or a strategy level. I will also show you an action item also, how this can be done.
Yeah. Maybe before that, can we just have a reaction in the chat window of everybody's on with us? is everybody listening and can tell us if they're on with us in the chat window. Thank you.
Yeah, and if you have just any questions.
Or send a thumbs up so that we know. Yeah,
we know that you're listening. And also, if you have any questions, you can just type up. Ambika, you can keep an eye on the chat window for questions. Yeah,
sure.
We can take them.
Okay. Thanks, Suresh.
Great, wonderful. Yes. That's good. Okay, so let's first look at when we are looking at how to design a learning culture. Hmm. We are talking about creating ownership and responsibility, creating a learning culture in such a way that it engages employees. That is the objective. Now, to do that, we first need to understand what the employees want. If we are not clear about what they want, then how do we design something? So first, taking a step back, as I said, taking a step back, doing some diagnosis and homework so we can create a learning culture which is high on return. So let's look at what do employees want. Now, this model is derived from another psychology model, which is called six core needs. Now, although this particular model is based on personal psychology, but this actually applies very well in terms of organizations also. And I will share this detail and you will see how this actually applies. So when we talk about six core needs, we talk about needs of a person, regardless of what their age is, what their social status is, what their educational background is, which country they live in, what language they speak, what food they eat. None of that matters. You strip all those layers, everything you strip of the person, and then what is left, the person, what is left? These are so core, so fundamental that it can be applied to anywhere, any place, any country, anytime. This is why we call them six core needs.
So one of the things that you need to really see here is that these needs are also applicable to you. So for you to understand a major problems of your own life, also this can help. So I just want to drive your attention in both ways, not only for the organization, but for yourself also. This next 20 minutes of this model might be very helpful.
Yes. So what Ambika mentioned is that when you relate it to yourself, when you see that how this applies to you, then you can see that if this applies to you, then it applies to everybody. That's as simple as that. So this is the way to relate to it. So don't see it as something for another person. First see it for yourself. And if you're convinced, then this will apply to everybody else also. So the six core needs are divided into three, we can call it like three levels. Each level has two of them. And I'll go through one by one. So someone is not on mute. We have some background noise.
Yeah, I'll just mute everyone.
Yes, except me. Yeah.
And me. Yes.
Okay. So first, on level one, we have two core needs that every person wants is to have consistency in their life and to have variety also. So by consistency, we mean that we want to make sure that things are running smoothly. So I will only talk about this in terms of an organization. So what does consistency mean in terms of an organization? It means that when I turn up to work, I want to make sure that my company still exists. If my company is struggling and I don't know whether I would have my job today, tomorrow, or whatever, then that kind of environment will always keep me on my toes. And in that, if my company or my manager or my leader is expecting me to perform, then you forget about it. Because my base, my roots are shaken. I'm not even sure whether I will have a job tomorrow or not. In that one, I cannot concentrate on my work. Can we have everyone on mute, please? Yes, thank you. So if my base is shaken, then you cannot expect me to perform. So please, this is for business leaders also, to make sure that when you are thinking about introducing this culture, the culture should consider these facts. If my job role is not defined properly, I don't even know what I'm expected to do. Today, my manager says do this. Tomorrow, my manager says do that. Change their mind, all that. Then I'm always struggling to have a grasp on what exactly I'm supposed to do. So that kind of consistency, people expect. This is bare minimum consistency that that I would expect from my work environment. At the same time, there is variety that I also want, meaning that I don't want to just keep doing the same thing again and again, same job for next 10 years, 20 years. I want something to challenge me. If I'm doing the same role, after a while, that role becomes very easy for me. I can just close my eyes and just do it. So my challenge level goes down, and we all want to be pushed somewhere. We want to do things that stretches us, that help us to...
Gives us a challenge.
Give us a challenge. So you know, all that is very required. Not in the sense that today my manager says do this, tomorrow my manager says do that. Not that kind of variety. Too much of variety also is not a very good idea. The idea over here is that there should be a balance between consistency and variety. I want both. If there is too much consistency, it becomes boring. If it's too much variety, it becomes confusing. It becomes anxious. The whole thing, I'm not sure what is going on. So, you know how when you are traveling and doing this and that, and then whenever you have some very good time, but when you come back home, you just feel so good coming back home. It's like that. You appreciate home even more after traveling. So that is the balance that you want. You want consistency and variety, both in the work environment. Ambika, anything you want to add?
I just feel that everybody's looking for a change once in a while, right? Like we look for a profile change, or we'll just want to change a job because it's got monotonous. It's as simple as that. Consistency, variety is like you need to know what you come to, when you come to work, what you need to do. But at the same time, you want some change in your profile, some challenge, something to be ambitious for as well. Maybe a promotion, maybe a change of profile, maybe a change of department. So things like that keeps us going. So that's what, and we here we're talking about a balance. So why we say balance is because both these things are equally important. Most times, I think, especially in a setup like ours, if it could be that consistency is a lot and variety is missing, or could be reverse also, you guys could share with us. So see what is in this moment when it comes to your job or your work, or with the lockdown, maybe consistency is too much. The same walls you have to see every day. Where is variety and consistency for yourself?
Good. Thanks, Apika. So let's go to the next level. So once, let's say this is there, your work environment has been set up in a way that people are getting a good balance of consistency and variety. Then the next thing that they will look for is a balance between significance and connection. Now, this means that as a human being, one of my need is to be part of a team, but then secretly I also want to lead that team. But what happens that we have all heard that if you are at a leadership level, then it's a very lone position. You have less friends. As you keep moving up the ladder, you become lonelier and lonelier. This is what people have told us. Can we mute everyone, please? Thanks. So for that reason, many people are afraid also to go down that track, although they want it, but they also don't want to be left alone. So give them an environment which is giving them a balance between connection and significance, where they are not only part of a team, but their individual achievements are also celebrated. One of the good examples is cricket. In cricket, there is a man of the match and the whole team is also awarded, whoever wins. So individual achievements need to be celebrated. Many companies, many organizations, many teams, many team leaders, business leaders, they actually make it a point sometimes to not do that. They go by this saying that there is no I in the team. So what happens is when you go by this belief, there is no I in the team, then you average everybody. People who are burning the midnight oil, who are spending more time and efforts, tomorrow, when you have got an achievement and you make it look like a team achievement that everyone has done it, and not recognizing those people who have put extra efforts, it discourages them. Next time they will not do it, because what is the point? They are going to be averaged out with everyone. So this is how you bring the average of the entire team down, by not identifying the star performers. Now you might argue and say that this will increase jealousy and competition and all that. There is a chance for that, but then that is the job, is how you bring that balance. Just because those risks are there, that doesn't mean you don't do it. So you have to figure out a way by which you don't have those things happening.
Hello.
But then at the same time, you have your star performers identified and recognized also.
Ah, yes, sir.
We again have some disturbance.
I see.
I've made mute. I've made mute to all.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. What happens is the participants unmute themselves and then again have to mute them.
Okay. No problems.
So I've done that again. Yeah.
Thank you. So as a business leader, another role is to create this culture, create this environment so that you bring a balance. So people get both. They don't feel that their individual performance is not getting shine, because this is the reason why office politics increases. You know, when you are not recognizing this, then people will find their own unresourceful ways of creating significance. This is a reason. You are actually giving them a reason to increase office politics, because they are not feeling that they are recognized, they are appreciated, they are acknowledged. And then they will find their own unresourceful, bad, evil ways of creating that kind of significance. So if you address that, that is a way of how you can bring the office politics down as well. Not only that, employee engagement will also improve because of fixing this one part in the culture. Anything you want to add, Ambika, to this? You might be on mute. Okay, so going forward, the last level. So assuming those four are taken care of, then the next thing that everybody wants is, in some shape or form, we all crave to grow and to contribute. This is our human nature. Once again, as I said, that strip away everything that you know. So sometimes we may have these biases or these judgments that this happens in private sector, doesn't happen in public sector, or public sector, this happens in public and not happen. I'm asking you today is to just strip off all those things and experiment with this. There's nothing like this, that this only happens in here and can't happen in there. It's not like that. You try this out and then you see whether this is true for you or not. But at a core level, every human being wants to grow and to contribute. And if we create an environment, the one that we have, marked as green. So this is the learning culture. This is the organization culture that we're talking about. If the learning culture, organization culture is designed in such a way that those four core needs are taken care of for people, that they're not worried whether they have a job or not tomorrow, if their job is not clear, all that. If they are not acknowledged, rewarded, recognized, acknowledged, if you have taken care of all that, then all that is left for them to do is to do their job, grow and contribute. that will be the one on their mind. Then they will not be spending their time in the other areas because you have taken care of it. As a leader, you have fixed it. You have implemented solutions and created a culture in such a way that those four needs are taken care of. So that is what an employee would want from their organization culture, from their learning culture as a whole. Moving, so before we move, is there anything you want to add, Ambika, here? Are you there? Okay, I think, so you are muted in case if you are trying to say something.
Yeah, now I'm unmuted. Thank you for this. Yeah, nothing from my side. I just wanted to bring someone, if anybody wants to kind of share something that they have picked up so far from the session.
Any question has come up? Anything anyone has asked?
No question has come up so far, but I would like maybe people to contribute at this moment just to see whether we are going in the right way.
So any
reflection on the growth and contribution stage, or which stage do you think you are getting challenged in your team right now?
We can have an interactive session if you want to have, if you have a question at any point, just ask and we can. So
yeah.
Let's keep moving forward.
Sure.
There's nothing so far.
Sure.
Okay. So how do we bring this about? What exactly are we saying? What do we need to do? What we are saying is that we create an empowerment-based learning culture, a culture that empowers people. And empowerment is a very used word, so to speak. And I'm sure that you all understand the word empowerment, what it means in terms of dictionary meaning of it. But how many of us actually have experienced it or have done it? That is the question. That is a question for self-reflection. This is not an academic question. There's no exam going on over here that I'm asking, what is empowerment? And you give me a definition of it. I would actually like you to dig deeper and think that, have you experienced it yourself? Have you done it to somebody else? And if yes, then I would actually like to know. If someone would want to share their experience, then they can unmute and share. This picture that you see, there's a concept called Ubuntu. This is from South Africa. And this is an example of how empowerment works. So what happens is, when someone makes a mistake, then that person is called in the center of the village. And everybody in that village gathers around that person and they shower them with all the good things that they have done. They remind them about all the good things. They don't talk about the mistake. They don't talk about that this person has done this wrong. They know that everyone is capable of making mistakes. We all make mistakes every day on a daily basis. Does that make us bad people? No. We do 10 good things. We do one or two bad things, and that's the only thing that other people notice, and they start lecturing and they start telling us how to correct it and all that. That is not the point. The other person is already feeling down. So at this point, the job of the village is to not remind this person about the mistake that they have done, but to remind this person of all the good things that they have done. And this doesn't go on for a few minutes or few hours. This actually goes on for a few days in some cases. So this is so much. They get overwhelmed with so much goodness that people share, that whatever this person who made a mistake may have done something nice for one person in the village. They will come and tell them, this is what you have done. This is how my life has changed and all that. So them hearing all these stories from so many different people lift them up. Build the confidence in this person that just because I made one small mistake, or it could be a big mistake also, I'm not going down big or small mistake. it's a mistake. So we, rather than reducing the person to the mistake that they have done, is not only reminding the person about how good they have been, but also reminding themselves that this person is actually good. Good people can also make mistakes. Good people can also do bad things. This is fine. This is acceptable. And because we accept it, we see this gray part in life, rather than seeing it black and white, that good people can't make bad decisions and bad people can't make good decisions. Seeing things black and white that way does not work. You tell me, you all have been on earth for so many years. How many of you have ever come across a person who is purely good and purely bad? There is always some good in the bad and there is always some bad in the good. This is how it is. The gray, life is gray. I don't know why we continue to see it black and white, although there is no proof that it is black and white, but we still continue to see it. We still want to see it that way. We don't accept someone making a mistake and because we consider them as a role model or big or good person or whatever. This puts a lot of pressure on us and the other person also. And then what happens that sometimes when we are seeing the other person that way, then even if they have made a mistake, they will try to cover it because they can't ruin their image in front of you. They know that how you see it. So they will try to cover it up. And this will lead to other problems in the company. And I'm sure that you can relate that how many problems it will create if you have created an image about a person and the person cannot deviate from that image. They also know that. So they will do everything to maintain that image. And that is going to create problems. Anything you want to add, Ambika?
No, I just wanted to say if we could do this with our children, what could change? I'm sure there are many parents in the audience. And in this moment, if you could think of one incident where your child committed a mistake and how we behave with them, and how we behave if a colleague does, and how different those two things are for us. Or if someone does something in the traffic line, you know, cuts you off, what is your reaction? And all those things kind of sum up to some other way of mistakes, or something that is not right, something that is not ethical, something that is not the way you would like the world would look like. So yeah, practicing Ubuntu has changed many lives, and it's a very popular model across the US in corporates. So that's the reason we have brought it here as well. So let's see what people have to share about this.
So I talked a lot about this part because I wanted to make sure that we don't stay with the bookish knowledge of empowerment. I actually share an example of empowerment with you, that how it is actually done in practice. This is a ritual. This is a practice that is there. So I'm sharing it with you. So you also see that it is not a word to be discussed. It is something which can be practiced, and how we can bring this learning culture, how we can bring this into our learning culture is what is left to you. So some homework you also need to do. So I'm sharing this example for that reason.
Sure.
All right, so let's move on. Now, as I mentioned that we have been talking about strategy, design considerations so far, we will move more into how we can implement some ways also. So I'm not just going to leave it at a vague level. So there are some key elements to consider when we are considering a learning culture, some key elements to consider. And I'm including 7 here. There could be many more. It's not that it's just 7. Because of the time and all that, even if we do these 7 for now, this is good. This is a good start. This is actually a very good start. If you can include these key 7 key elements while you are designing your learning culture, that would be great.
Also, these why these 7 is because they've been put together after a research by Forbes, like studying organizations across the globe. So these seem to be the key elements across organizations. And no wonder yours is not an exception. So we believe that this would work.
Yes, that's right. So once again, this is a tried and tested model. This is not something which we are just sharing as a theory. This is something which can be implemented. The first element to consider in a learning culture is development of emotional intelligence. Now we have probably heard of this phrase emotional intelligence. I'll just touch upon very quickly on this. Emotional intelligence means becoming intelligent about our own emotions and the emotions of the other person, is becoming intelligent enough to handle our own emotions and the emotions of the other people around us. While developing emotional intelligence, we don't consider that any emotion is good or bad. Emotions are emotions. They all have a reason, a need. They become good or bad is because we don't know how to handle them. For example, anger. Anger has a role to play in our life. Just because we don't know how to handle anger productively, and it goes out of hand, and it goes out of control, we then go into guilt, or we go into other kind of problems with that, that we start labeling it as bad. So if we understand it and how we can handle it, then there is no problem in even showing anger, because it is also a very good tool to have. And doing that, learning how to do that, is part of emotional intelligence. So if a learning culture can enable your employees, your teams, to handle their emotions well, then nothing like it. That would be a great learning culture that will help people to move towards that empowerment. Next is communication. So having good communication skills, developing good communication skills is also part of a learning culture. Now, communication here often doesn't just mean writing good emails or doing good presentations or talking better in English or better in this language or that language. That is there. That is definitely there as part of communication. But communication also means to communicate what we are actually feeling. So acknowledging our feelings and understanding them and able to communicate to the other person in a way that is emotionally intelligent is not only empowering for me, but also empowering for the other person. Sometimes we feel one way, but then we, when we talk to the other person, when we communicate our point, we try to be more diplomatic or polite or this or that, and we kind of not really hitting the nail on the head. We are not congruent in our communication. We think and feel something, but we say something else, because we probably attended a communication program, a training, and that told us that you should write an email like this. You should write like that. That is all fine. Those are words. I'm not talking about words. I'm talking about the mindset. What frame of mind you should be in before you communicate. So that is part of a good learning culture also, is how to develop that mindset of communication.
So for example, right now we were talking about Ubuntu, right? So in terms of communication, now if someone commits a mistake in a normal mainstream corporate setup, there is a sense of blame, there is a sense of, then, you know, people will go on to this accountability spree saying that, what are their responsibilities? Let's, you know, it, sometimes it goes to KRA, and actually it ends up in even a discussion on a JD, like on what were you hired for and things like that. Now, versus if we develop a learning culture which practices Ubuntu, what would that communication be looking like? How would you handle as a leader if you were to practice Ubuntu instead of blaming in terms of mistakes? That is what we are talking about. So we're not talking about the words you use, and the words definitely change. The tone changes, the syntax changes, the way we handle everything changes when that base philosophy on which the organization operates change. And that is what learning culture is. It's not only one element or the other. We are definitely putting forward 7 elements, but not forgetting the base on which this is all happening. So that's why communication, not as words, but as a mindset, is what we are planning to put forward here.
Authentic communication is what authentic. You are feeling, is what you are describing. But in order to be authentic and in order for you to communicate that to the other person, you need to be emotionally intelligent yourself. So you need to develop that that part first. Critical thinking. So another element of a good learning culture is to develop a critical thinking mindset of people as well. So this is about thinking from many different angles, thinking from many different point of views, or considering other point of views also. So not just that because I thought of it this way and this is the only way, is being open to receive inputs from others, is being open to consider inputs from others, even if they are completely random, completely, I don't really, it might be something which I would have never thought. Okay, that is the whole point. Because you can never think about it, somebody else is thinking, that itself shows that those kind of people also exist in the world who think like that. So understanding that and not criticizing the other person that how can you think this way, or why you thought this way and that way, is not emotional intelligence. And then again, not a very good way of communicating. All these things are not separate. They are all interlinked. Is how we empower the other person, is to come forward, is to share, not feel, not self-doubt them, not feel, feel bad or blow on their self-esteem that why are you thinking this way, how can you think it this way, and all that. So this is about you, consider, all different point of views, because that is the whole point. When we say different point of views, that means it is going to be different than what I think. But letting the other person explain, clarify what is the rationale behind coming from this point of view, I don't understand because I don't think this way. I am a person who is this kind, and this is a person who's that kind. Now, going in their shoes and trying to figure out why that person is thinking this way, and inviting them to explain, to express. This encourages people, even if the idea is not good, even if we are not going to go ahead with it, doesn't matter. The person will feel valued. The person will feel that you heard me. At least I got a chance to explain. At least you didn't shut me down. So this is part of critical thinking, because we cannot, just one person cannot do critical thinking from all angles. You can do critical thinking from all angles that you can think of, but you cannot do critical thinking on all angles, because there will be many angles you can never think of. So this is about creating that kind of learning culture in which people respect different point of views. And not only just respect, but invite. Once again, this will, and I'll keep pointing back to the original problem. We talked about diversity and inclusion. Doing this is going to impact on the diversity and inclusion part of it, because people will not feel that they are different. They feel included, because we are creating a culture in such a way that these problems will automatically start getting solved. We don't have to do anything separately for diversity and inclusion. Just including people when they have something to say, making them feel included, making them feel valued, is going to solve that problem by itself. Anything you want to add, Ambika, or move forward? You're on mute. Okay. The next part is lateral thinking. So another thing which is missing, we all value very structured way of thinking a lot, because this is how our education system is. Lateral thinking is something which is completely out of the box. And this is like, I'm trying to figure out how to explain. So I'll explain it with a puzzle. So there's a puzzle that I read. So I have a lateral thinking book, which I really love. And one of the puzzles in that book is, there is a guy who lives on 10th floor. And every time he goes in the lift, when he has to go down, he doesn't press the buttons using his umbrella. He has a stick. Sorry, not an umbrella, a stick. He doesn't. But when he goes up, he always presses the button using umbrella. Or sometimes he goes to 5th floor and then he walks the rest. Why would that be? So since everyone is muted and no one is chatting that much, I'll just say. So this is basically the puzzle talks about that the guy is actually a midget. So he can reach the ground floor button on the lift, but he cannot reach the 10th floor button because it's too high up from his height. So for that reason, he has to use either a stick, or he can only reach up to button 5 and he goes up to level 5 and then he walks the rest. So this is an example of a lateral thinking puzzle. And there are books available to actually explore this. This is one of my fun time. It's very, some of these puzzles are really good. And I'll encourage you, again, part of a learning culture is to include that. So people think outside the box, because these realities of life also exist. This is how things are as well. Nobody can tell me that this example I just shared as a puzzle cannot be actually a real life struggle for someone in day-to-day life. This comes from there only. So looking at problems from those kind of angles is also part of a good learning culture, is to help develop that lateral thinking in people. And when you have this kind of setup, let's say you create this kind of setup, wouldn't you think that it will impact on employee engagement? Wouldn't you think that it will bring people together? People who actually like these kind of things will bond, will give people something to bond over, to bring them together and share something. Not only they will learn, but that will also improve employee engagement. So once again, fixing the root is going to start fixing the fruits.
True.
Creativity. I don't really have to say much about the topic of creativity. So creating a learning culture that help people to improve on their creativity is a must. That element needs to be there. Once again, this will also be a bonding point for many people to engage. This will bring many people together. Some people might be interested in lateral thinking activities. Some people might be interested in creativity related activities. So by providing these kind of environment, these kind of setups, you start to bring people together and employee engagement increases. And if employee engagement increases, then why would they leave? Then you don't have to worry about retention or high attrition, because people are happy. And this will also give them variety in their work. No? Consistency you have already given them in terms of the job that they are doing, but this could be a variety that you are offering them. So then they feel more motivated, more engaged, and that will also bring down the attrition rate in the company.
True.
So start to see the link between all these things. I will point them out, but I will also like you to start to see that these things are all by just doing one part of it, how many problems you are actually solving.
Yeah. We have a sharing on the chat window. It's someone called KE. Could you please share your name? He or she is sharing that involving all the team members in discussion will give new ideas and different perspectives and creativity.
Absolutely. It is we talk about innovation.
Okay.
How else you will have innovation? By these forums only, na? When you have these kind of forums, these kind of setup within the company where people can come together and share ideas, this and that, that is how innovation is going to work. Otherwise, we just keep talking about innovation, doing different things, new ways, all that. But then there is no environment, there is no culture, there is no setup available. Then how to get
so that innovation? It's basically like if we want the kids to play, we should build a playground. If we want them to participate, we must create a game. And if we want them to win, then we must empower them. So this is creating a beautiful playground and a space where people could express, feel inclusive, and take their ideas in from wherever they come. No matter if they are, many a times there could be points where it's not relevant fully. But just making them feel so that, because it's if it's play, we don't mind. The thing is, sometimes we take things too seriously and then it's very difficult to entertain anything that's not totally in line with what's happening or the outcome. So we become too outcome and too result focused once in a while. So letting a little loose and seeing this as more of a game, a play, and not making it frivolous. So I'm not saying that we should reduce the importance of the meeting or the outcome. There's no devaluing the focus on results, but at the same time, keeping that energy a little more lighter is what would encourage creativity to really blossom.
Yes. This is about giving them a little bit of downtime, but then at the same time, this downtime is actually helping them to improve their performance.
Yeah.
And how they come back and do the work, it will actually help them more that way.
Right.
Because whatever they identify, whatever they learn from all these activities, this is going to impact their performance at work, their communication skills, their relationships within the team. Everything is going to get impacted. This is for sure that it will happen. The next is dexterity. Dexterity means doing something with hands. So making people, not just only having discussions and this and that kind of thing, but also doing something with hands and doing something more practical, more down to earth. So actually get involved, do something, not just sit on chairs and just talk and all that, but actually get up and do something. So those kind of, that is also a learning culture. Sometimes we learn by doing things also. Learning doesn't only mean sitting in a classroom, watching a video, reading a book and discussions and all that. Some people learn in the classroom, some people learn in the playground. So just because someone is playing, you cannot just say that they're not learning anything. Play also teaches us a lot of things. So building that culture, bringing that play in the picture as well, the helping people to do something with hands, and it could be very well linked to your CSR activities. You can bring your CSR activity into this learning culture where they actually do something, go out and do something in the society or, whatever your CSR projects are. You can make them part of the learning culture. That way you kill two birds with one stone. You already doing your CSR initiatives. Then why not make it a learning culture also? So people learn something out of it as well, not just do it as a CSR activity only. So once again, this will improve employee engagement.
And I think more so also because the company and the organization is related to chemicals and land and so many other things might be a part of your work. which you haven't thought of yet, but I invite you today to really see what are those untouched territories where people can go and actually use their hands. One of the things I recently heard in a startup they did is that they put up these blackboards that we had in school and chalks instead of markers. And they are actually just wanting that back to school kind of a look to the office, and also people doing something with their hands, and it's more closer to where we come from. So things like that. So very simple changes, but something very common, probably commonsensical, but it's quite uncommon right now in the moment. And so think about a few ideas about your own office, maybe just change to a desk. Let's see.
Great. Thanks, Sambhika. And then the last point is ultimately imagination and vision. So when we talk about growth and contribution, as we talk that people want to grow, people want to contribute. So giving them a purpose, giving them a vision, or aligning them, aligning their purpose and their vision to the company, to whatever, encouraging that. This is also part of a good learning culture where we learn from each other's purpose and we get to contribute. We get to contribute in each other's purpose as well. That helps people to improve their imagination. And again, I don't have to tell you what an improved imagination will do to for your innovation or for anything new that you want to do, how important that is. So these are all the tools that we need to sharpen. We need all these things. We just need the right kind of stone where we can sharp these axes on now. So these are some 7 key elements I would like to share as part of creating a great learning culture. If we include all of them, for a very long time, you don't have to worry about more for now. I'm sure there will be more elements that you could consider. But I think even if you consider these 7 for now, that is very good start, and it will create a culture of empowerment. And it will then, when we say culture of empowerment, when I feel empowered, okay, then you don't have to tell me to take ownership and responsibility. I automatically take ownership and responsibility because I feel empowered. I feel that I have this, I own this. So we don't tackle ownership and responsibility directly. Ownership and responsibility is not a problem to be solved directly. It is a problem to be solved indirectly by doing this, by making people feel empowered. And when I feel empowered, I feel I should take ownership and responsibility. I automatically take ownership and responsibility for my own things, day-to-day things that I'm doing. When I don't have to ask anyone for permission each and every time, small things and all that, when I feel empowered, I take initiative. I take ownership and responsibility. You don't have to tell people to take ownership and responsibility. You just have to clear their way. Sometimes the leaders are themselves in the way. They are the ones who are actually taking away the permission from them. They are themselves in the way. The exact thing they are wanting is what they are actually not giving.
Yeah.
But they don't see it.
Yeah.
So seeing it that way, you clear the path. You don't have to do much. All you have to do is just get yourself out of the way and empower people. Trust them. Trust them that they will do it. And trust doesn't mean that they will not make mistakes. Again, empowerment doesn't mean you will not make mistakes. Empowerment means that even if the person is making mistakes, you remind them of all the good that they have been doing. You remind them of their strengths. If you continue to remind someone about their weakness, you're going to bring their vibration down. You're going to bring them down. Then they will not see the goodness in them because they are already down. They're already feeling bad. And now you're reminding them of that. That's not empowerment. The more you shower them with goodness, the more they have more confidence, the less chance they will have make that mistake again or a different mistake because they will be remembering their strengths.
Yeah, I also feel that not to devalue feedback here. Okay. a lot of people think that empowerment hoga to feedback kaise denge, how will we point out the lacune or like something that is not going right, and that is not the intention at all here. The intention is very simple, to see what is good. At the same time, you basically sandwich it a little bit. You address it from an empowerment point of view and not from a disempowerment point of view. Having a conscious choice of empowering the person in spite of the feedback is what we are talking about. So like an example, a good example would be that we share sometimes things about, say, the government. It's everybody has an opinion about how the government should behave, or the people should behave, or the neighbor should behave. But at the same time, can we see that, okay, the person is running the country, or is running my house, or is running this team, or is doing that task? Just acknowledgement in the first place is very important for the person. And then if you go ahead and share something that is not so good, it would still be taken in full spirit. So making them receptive also is empowerment. And then when people develop respect for you, when you start sharing from this clean space, then feedback is not a problem. Then it's always taken in the right spirit. But I'm very sure all of us have experienced that moment when we have not taken, when our feedback wasn't taken in the right spirit. So not devaluing it at all.
Yes, yes, that's a good point, Ambika. Good thing you mentioned that. So thanks for that. Yes, so we are not devaluing the importance of it. We actually would like you to link all this rather.
Yeah, very much. Use all of it together.
So take whatever you already know and apply this on top of it. So make it even better. So not asking you to leave anything what you're doing, but improve it with this new knowledge. Yeah. Okay, so going to the next level down is now going towards what are some of the standard components of a learning culture, what a learning culture would look like. So we know this, we having some coaching program in place. So wherever someone needs one-on-one attention, some hand-holding, guiding, then putting a coaching program in place. It could be one-on-one, it could be a group coaching also. So that's part of a learning culture, right? We talked about emotional intelligence and all that. So sometimes some people need extra care. They don't just get it because you shared an example. It's not that they're stupid or anything like that, but just some people need more time to absorb the content and they just need more extra care, some extra nurturing to be there. So having a coaching program as part of a learning culture is a good component.
I also feel that coaching
Okay, thanks for that. Yeah, Ambika, what were you saying? You have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, so I was saying that, I forgot my point again.
Okay, it will come.
Coaching, yes. So about coaching, I feel that coaching is very different from training. A lot of leaders I have met during my time with corporates is, a lot of times people think coaching is like counseling or whatever. I feel that it is very important for some issues to have a coaching session, then a training session. And understanding coaching ability as also a leadership quality is a very important factor. So I was part of a team development at MDocs when we were developing their leaders as coaches. And they thought that one of the topmost qualities of a leader is coaching, because that has reduced conflicts and brought empowerment to a very large extent in the organization. So like we are trying to build a learning culture, they actually built coaching culture over there. That's how much importance they felt it was, important it was. So the reason why I'm seeing these are two different things is because they have a very different way of handling queries and getting into topics, and it's more personal also. So it's way more powerful a lot of times for a lot of individuals. So, yes, yeah.
True. Next is mentoring. Again, coaching and mentoring are two different things. Mentoring is something which is very much academic in nature. So mentoring is guiding someone in terms of their career, their profession, or whatever they are planning to do. So putting a mentoring program in place where, let's say, if you are planning to develop a new leader and for succession planning, or there is a junior engineer who wants to now see how they can become a senior engineer and all that. So there's that path. So buddying them up with someone senior in the organization so they can see what they need to do in order to go from this to that point is part of the mentoring program. Coaching, whereas, is more around more soft skills related issues where they are having trouble with their team members or personal problems or other kind of things. They need more extra care around that. That is where coaching will come handy. So just to differentiate between these two. And both of them will help people to learn. Again, part of a learning culture only. Different setups because there are different problems. They solve different problems. Mm-hmm. So we need to be very clear about the difference between them.
Right.
As Ambika already mentioned, trainings is there. It's separate to coaching. So having good soft skills trainings programs as part of a learning culture is very important. Skills development trainings, which is as what I do in terms of what I do, how can I do that better if I'm in quality, if I'm in engineering, if I'm in systems or IT or whatever, how can I do my job better? The trainings that I need for that is also very important part of a learning culture. So people can upskill, people can do their job better. We can't just keep expecting perform better, but actually not giving them skills upgrade there. So recognizing that, having those as part of the culture is important. These mostly are done. Now, there's one more element which is often get missed, which I would like to talk about, is learning journeys. Now, learning journeys are something that not many companies, not even in private sector also, is done that much. Some companies have started recognizing this. So what we discussed before, emotional intelligence, communication, lateral thinking, dexterity, learning journey is a hand-holding program. So I'll give you an example. Let's say you want to learn how to drive a car. If someone just gives you a skills development training, then it's not enough for you to know how to drive a car. You need someone to sit with you when you are driving the car. They check whether you are doing it correctly or not, and then they are correcting you and taking you from one point to the other. So that is a journey where you are taken up to a point where you feel comfortable that, okay, you are not an expert in driving car anymore, but you are there up to a point where you say, I know now, I can take it from here. So taking people up to that point, and emotional intelligence is one of those things which you cannot inculcate in someone by just giving them topics and concepts or training or even coaching in that sense, because you need to actually be part of their journey for a while and make sure that the person is doing it correctly and is going in the right pace and all that. So bringing those kind of programs in place, which we call learning journeys, is an essential part of a learning culture, which is very much missed. We feel that by doing coaching, mentoring, and training, we have covered it. But along with coaching, mentoring, and trainings, we need journeys also. And that is one of the key points that I would like to leave today in this presentation is to think about how you can introduce learning journeys in your learning culture as well. And I'll give you an example of this as well. So to make it more sharper, to make it more understandable what we mean, I'll give you an example. But yeah, Ambika, you have something?
Yeah, we have a question on the chat window. It is, can you give live examples of any organizations? And the context, the questioner is mentioning is learning culture. So basically, an example of live how we do it, the learning culture part. So I would just like to say that maybe listen to the next part as an example of an initiative that we take as a part of this culture. And then maybe we can share about Wonderland and other clients that we've worked with.
So yes, that's good. As I said that, you know, examples, there are several organizations that have got coaching programs in place, mentoring programs in place, training programs in place. I'm sure RCF would have some of that element also in there. So these are standard components that already exist. Yeah. Now, what we are showing here is that if we link this to the previous slides that I was sharing, the seven key elements, and we start to say what kind of coaching programs, what kind of mentoring programs, what kind of soft skills trainings. So if we link these to that and start introducing more meaningful of these things, then it becomes even better. And I'm introducing the next concept of learning journeys over here as well, is how to bring those seven key elements alive in your culture by somewhere doing coaching, somewhere doing mentoring, somewhere doing training, somewhere doing journeys like that.
Perfect. Weaving it all together.
Weaving it all together. And, you know, these examples are countless. This almost every company has some or the other happening. But we are talking about making it more relevant, making it more so you get more return on investment. So doing it with more consciousness, doing it with more awareness that what my people actually need, rather than just saying, for the sake of it, let's just do these training programs.
Yeah, so basically not having tick in the box kind of understanding, but understanding it fully, aligning it to the goal of the organization, then to the goal of the teams, and then to yourself and others. So from a personal goal to a group goal, to a group goal, to a collective goal, and from a collective goal to an organization goal. So that's the alignment is what we are trying to build in the
learning. That's the alignment what we are trying to build. We are saying, you're doing what you're doing, but just do it differently now. Do it in a bit more improved way.
And in an aligned way.
In an aligned way.
The results that you want.
Yes. So how we have implemented a learning journey, we are currently doing a program. It's called Becoming Emotionally Intelligent Through Stories. So we have created a 4 weeks program that is based on stories, which we call Tales of Master Buji. So this is 4 weeks program where we show. So this program is for HR professionals and business leaders at the moment. They are joining. Nearly 100 people have participated in this program so far. For the last 3 months, we have been doing. Fourth month is starting in January. What this program does is every week we introduce a story. There is no context given to people. There is no explanation given. It is like I give them the exam first and they learn the lesson later. So you get the story on a Sunday and then people get 2 days to think about what that story means. Now, these stories are incomplete. There is no ending to this story. The reader has to figure out what are the hidden emotional intelligence and mindfulness related messages in this story. Mm-hmm. They get 2 days to do that. They discuss within their own group. And then on a Tuesday night, we come on a call and we discuss what have they found. And in those calls, people will share their different perspectives about the, how they interpreted this story, how the story might end. So if there are 20 people on the call, you can see that maybe the story might end in 10, 15 different ways because there is no end. I haven't given them an end to this story. It's an incomplete story. So they will come up with different endings of that story. They'll interpret it. And then based on that interpretation, Then we give them some experiments to conduct. These experiments are so they can experience what they have just identified. And only experience can bring out emotional intelligence. So week by week, we do this. Then on Saturday, we meet again and we discuss how they have implemented, what they have identified, what changes they have observed in themselves. They maintain a journal with them. And in that journal, they note down what they are experiencing. So this process goes for 4 weeks. So four stories, four different stories, same process repeated 1 week after the other. So the message gets hammered. You know, you go through this thing because you can't just develop emotional intelligence by one talk or one discussion or 1 week. So 4 weeks is very good time frame where they start to experience a shift in their own self-awareness, a shift in their own empathy. And I'm not just saying this. This is what people are saying. So here are some of the examples of what people have gone through and what they have experienced. And this, although this is a 4 weeks program, majority of people start to see the shift in them in 2 weeks itself. By the end of 2 weeks, they will start to say, I'm now more aware. When I'm saying something, I know this thing is triggering me. I know that this person was saying something which was making me angry, and I can see that. And now my reactions are different. I am talking in a different way. I'm listening to people and very respectful of their different perspectives and all that, just in 2 weeks. So these are some.
Just a very simple example would be, we talked about Ubuntu in this presentation. So now, if we discussed a story about Ubuntu, the exercise that will follow would be practicing Ubuntu with like two people in that week. And then people come back and share about what was their experience, if someone made a mistake, how did they handle it, and how different it was. And it is a life-changing experience for most participants so far. It's because it's simple and it is experiential. People actually have to go and do these tasks. And that is what makes the difference, as against just listening, reading, or watching a concept in emotional intelligence. It's actually by doing it with real people, real time in their lives. That is what actually makes that difference.
And for you to know whether this thing works or not, we started this first batch in October.
Hmm.
Now we are doing fourth batch is going to start in January. And nearly the third batch that is currently going on, nearly 80 or 90% people who have joined batch 4, there are 44 people in that batch, are referrals, are people who have been referred by those who have attended previous batches. So they have seen the shift. They have seen that this learning journey actually brings a shift in them. And now they want to see that shift in their family members or their friends or their work colleagues. And now they are referring those people. So batch 3, nearly 90% of the batch is by referrals of those people who have attended. And batch 4 is right now starting in Jan, although there are about 12 people that have joined so far. All those 12 people, 100% is referral. I don't know any of them. Not even a single person I know who they are. But it's the people who have attended this and gone through these journeys, experienced this, are feeling empowered. And now they are passing that empowerment to others and they want others to experience it as well. So I'm just sharing this because someone is asked about the proof and all that. And I thought that that's a valid question. That is why I had these screenshots of that, this is the proof. This is the proof that these learning journeys work and they empower people. They empower so much that they want to share with others. They want more and more people to come forward and join these programs. So how wonderful that would be when we talk about return on investment, that you have a program which your employees refer to other employees and say, go and join this. You will be benefited. You wouldn't agree that the return on investment would actually be a lot better if such kind of programs are introduced.
And it's all about understanding the framework in which this is happening. it is not just one initiative. There is this whole framework that we have in place where all elements of employee touch points are taken care of in the same way that we are sharing one initiative at the moment. So when we build learning culture, there are so many touch points. It includes your interiors to the way we talk, the way we write an email, the way we recruit, to the way we induct, from induction to training, and so many other elements, one by one, are taken care of with the same philosophy in mind, with the same intensity also. And that's the reason the learning culture is developed. So this was one example of one initiative, but then on many levels, the same work has to be done for the learning culture to really come to life. And it has to be breathing in everyone. It can't be just on the walls of the organization, or it can't be just the email headers, as you may have understood by now. So that's the reason we like to do these experiments, so that it's experiential and it's my own learning, my own takeaway from the experiment and the concept. So that's the intention of learning journeys and building learning culture in the first place, or also I think the most fundamental thing that can happen.
Great. So just to recap on the flow so far, we talked about, we wanted to address ownership and responsibility factor, is how we can create ownership and responsibility by bringing a learning culture. And and then we talked about that, what will happen if you don't address ownership and responsibility, many problems are observed in the company. And then we talked about when we are designing learning culture, first we have to design it from an employee point of view. We have to understand what they want. I can't just come and say do this. It has to be employee centric. So to be employee centric, we need to understand what they want. So we shared the 6 core needs with you, that if you design something which takes care of those 6 core needs, participation would be a lot more. People will take it, the adoption, the sustainability would be a lot better if those 6 core needs are taken care of. And then we went towards introducing that the culture should enhance empowerment. It should empower people. That is what a culture should do. And then how to do that is, we shared 7 key elements that you should consider when you are designing these. So they will take care of the 6 core needs and the empowerment part if you have those 7 key elements that are there. Later we shared that how this is implemented. Generally speaking, this is a very common way of implementation. If you ask for an example where this is done, then I'll say everywhere. Almost every company has one or the other form of coaching programs going, training programs going, mentoring programs going. So everywhere this is there. But how effective it is, the question is that, how to make it more effective is by connecting it with the 7 key elements and the 6 core needs we talked about. So all that we talked about is now what needs to be tied together, not looked at separate things. There is a reason of this flow, is to show you this. And then we showed you a practical way of what a learning, because I thought that learning journey is something of a new concept. We all know what training means. We all know what coaching and mentoring means. So in order for me to explain learning journey better, I shared one of our examples. Now, this is not just meaning only this is a learning journey. This is an example of how we are inculcating emotional intelligence in people in just 4 weeks by doing this hand-holding program, which is very engaging in nature. We are doing it via stories. It's fun. There is no PowerPoint presentation. There is no discussion or no information download from our side. It's very conversation. So the engagement is such that now people are introducing other people. The reason for me to share all that with you, to show that if you introduce learning journeys in your organization, then the return on investment could be very good. If people are liking it and they're also asking other employees and other people to go and do this program, join this program, that means that you have implemented something very valuable and worthwhile. So that was that is how you bring out the ownership and responsibility in people.
One question we have is, can you throw some light on driving vision, mission, and values of an organization or a department?
Sorry, can you throw some light on deriving vision, mission, and values of an organization or a department? Yes. So,
great question to start with.
Yes. Somewhere during the conversation, Ambika mentioned that the alignment needs to be there, right? So when we talked about growth and contribution, and then in the seven elements, we also talked about imagination and vision. So every person has a life purpose. Every person has it. I'm just going to make this as a statement. Every person has it. Some people know, some people don't know it yet, but they have it. So it's a matter of doing it, doing some work with them and bringing it out. Now, in order to align people with the company vision, mission, and values is to first bring out the vision, mission of the person and the vision, mission of the department that they are working in. The vision of a company is way too high level for people to connect. I recently did an interview for HR Success Talk, and in that one, we covered this, that how we align the vision of an individual with the vision of the company. Now, let's say the vision of the company or any company, I'll just take random like that, is to reach 1000 CR in 2021. Now they hire a junior programmer or a junior engineer. Now what job description that junior engineer has, he doesn't see a direct link between what he does is how he is going to take the company to 1000 CR. He doesn't know that. What is the link between it? All he sees is that I'm just an engineer. I'm doing this work here. I'll go to another company. I'll do the same work over there also. So they might give me more money, or it might be other perks and all that. So the vision is not very clearly linked. There's a missing link here between the person and the company vision. There is a department level vision that needs to be done. So let's say, for example, if this person works for the IT department, now the IT department head needs to come up with a vision for their department to say what their department does in order to reach that 1000 CR goal. Now they may not be directly doing a revenue generation, but they say that presence, our availability, our reliability is critical for the success of this goal. So our systems can never go down. We need to make sure that we are 100% available. We need to make sure we are 100% secured. We are 100% available, because that is what is going to ensure that other people in the company can work towards that goal. So they are providing that support. They are the enablers there. Now, this person who is joining the IT department can relate to that more now. That, okay, my job is to make sure that the systems are available, that the systems are reliable, and the systems are secured and all that. As an IT person, I relate to that much better now. I know why I'm here and what my purpose is, what my vision is. And then the alignment of this with the company vision is what the heads can do. They see that what this alignment will be. But in order for a person at any level to align, they must align with their own department's vision. That is very, very important. That will bring them more close. That will engage them better. They will know that why I come to work every day, why I am here, what am I supposed to do? This is critical. This is very important. Not many organizations currently doing it, but there are few of our clients we have suggested, and they have tried this, and they have been they have given me a really good feedback about this. FEV is one of the companies. I suggested to their HR director to try this out, and she did, and she was very glad that this was done. That she first did it with her own HR department. And they created their own vision, mission of why HR exists in that company. And people felt more connected to the vision mission of the company that way, because now they see there is a connection between their department's vision and company's vision. So I just have to align with my department. And now I feel more connected what I do and what part I play and what I bring to the table. So this really motivated those people, and they started to see that now I can see the worth in what I do. Now I can see that why my job is so important. What am I really doing in this company and how I am bringing that value?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the ultimate thing is to thread it all together, to weave it together, my personal goal to my group goal, which is the team goal or a department goal, and then weaving it together with this thing. There was an exercise. I used to work with Deepak Fertilizers at one point in my life earlier. And in their AGM, they had a ritual where they would try and see how even CSR becomes a part of the game that Deepak Fertilizer is, the Deepak Fertilizer at large, how the company operates, and how they could weave it all together. So actually they would bring all the department heads together to take an oath, and then let everybody talk and align with each other. So this was an annual activity that they did. So I felt it was a great example how to weave it all together, because unless and until I'm emotionally connected to an organization, I am not going to take that ownership and responsibility. That's very clear. Yeah.
And often people ask us this question is, when is a good time to do this? So yeah. I think the first best time to do this is at the time of induction. That is the best time to do. When a new person is joining the company, doing this alignment, the vision, mission, values of the company with this person. So not just only sharing, this is our vision, this is our mission, this is our values. The person, that's just an information for that person. They don't connect with it. They don't connect that, how is my job in this company any different to this job in any other company? They don't connect. Frankly speaking, they don't connect. So this is an activity that needs to be done at the time of induction. Very important. And if that is missed, then when is the second best time? Is basically now. Any time is good to do it. So that is what I
also say. Also, sitting individually with people is very important. I feel when the reason why I felt connected personally to the organizations I worked for was because my managers made a point to sit with me, talk about my career goals, and showed me a path how this company could provide me that. It's very, you can say people are selfish, you can say people are self-centric, whatever you call your team, that doesn't matter, because that is how we all operate. So let's recognize that in a positive light, there's nothing wrong about being self-centric or self-career centric. But at the same time, as leaders, can we see that need of our employee and address it in a more creative, in a more empowering, and in a more ambitious way? And I understand top positions are limited and promotions is not something we can promise all the time. But can we still make them, even if it's a pawn, it has a role to play on the chessboard. Can we make that purpose very clear to them? I think that is where driving vision, mission, and values start. And they end also almost there, because I see my role to be more valuable, then I'm more connected. And then if I'm more connected, I would take complete ownership and responsibility of my KRA. So it's all, it's a circle. It's not a linear path. It's a cyclic motion.
There is an interconnection between all of this.
Interconnection, correct.
There is, yeah, you the just you cannot see any of this in isolation. You cannot just say,
yes.
Oh, but this is only this activity.
Yeah,
it's
don't
not like
be,
that. It's a web. You pull one string and other strings also get pulled. It's like that.
We treat the soil, we get a better crop. Let's do that. Simple. Yeah. Great. Any last bits, because we are time up, but we would like to still maybe take one last question if everybody is okay. Thank you, Krishna.
Also, just this question we answered was, is this answer good enough? Is there more that we need to say? Can we get some feedback that whether this answer was satisfactory or do we need to explain more?
Yeah, we'd like some feedback, definitely.
It was a good question, and I think it's important.
It brought it all together for us.
It's the answer is also equally good.
I think the session has been very interesting. I have unmuted all the participants in case if they have any queries or any this thing, you're free to put your questions in the chat box. And deriving it to the vision, probably it helped us understand it better. The last summary of aligning your individual goals to the organizational goals, and then how one can drive the department vision. So like different departments will have their own visions and missions, and then all coming together, we derive the organization vision. So this has been an interesting learning for all of us.
Yes, and again, this is very practical also, because people live, if I'm in HR department and the HR department's vision is, let's say, we want to make sure that the quality of our people grows day by day, right? So HR is not going to do anything directly in terms of revenue generation to reach 1000 CR. But the people who are working there, you need to make sure that their quality, their professional development is up to mark so they can perform, they can bring that 1000 CR, right? So if you now see that, so anyone who's joining the L&D or the recruitment, they now see, okay, I now know what I need to do. I need to make sure that I hire the best candidates. The L&D person will know I need to make sure that we introduce good learning programs, good learning culture, so this is reached and all that. And the heads of the department can talk to each other and say, I'm doing this. And together, by me doing this, by this doing that, we will reach this 1000 CR.
Rather, we have to work it backwards. You come out with a turnover, and in the similar manner, probably a marketing will decide the cutout for each year. If you reach at 1000 crore, probably at the end of 5 years, they could, you know, on the first year, they could reach to 500. So achieving a target of 5 years, they probably need to identify the locations which they need to tap and the marketing strength which they need to tap. And if it's a marketing strength, then HR again will have a role to play in the manpower
what
planning
kind of
to
people
provide
need
the role.
To bring
then the production will have a challenge of having that kind of a crop or that kind of an product to provide the marketing.
It's all interlinked.
So I think that goes hand in hand.
सबको 3019 का नंबर दे दो और बोलो कि टीम जो है उनके बंदे हैं।
हाँ, I think being making them unmute the individual conversation has started. So I think we'll stop here in case if nobody has any kind of a question. And thank you very much, Mr. Sachin and Ambika. This has been a very influential team where you know. It complimented really well, making us understand. Mr. Vilas, can you please mute yourself? Yeah. So I wanted to express here that Ambika and Sachin has been a very complimenting team where whatever was the learning, it was shared with real life examples, which made us really understand it well. And you've mentioned the different 7 key factors or the 7 components. I'm sure it sounds quite easy, like having an EQ, having a good communication, but implementing and taking it further is a real challenge. And probably making it more effective is one of the key source.
Correct.
About it.
Yes.
So thank you very much for this.
It's a good challenge to have.
Yeah. It's a very interesting challenge when you deal with human beings, and every human being has a different way to deal with. So it's an ongoing learning. So when you say learning in terms of technology, but dealing with people also is a new learning on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah. Thank you for everyone who is putting comments from RCF Vijayawada and Mr. Martin. Thank you so much for your feedback, and I would like everybody else also to at least share a thumbs up with us so that we know that it was a good presentation and it helped you or not. Thank you.
The mentoring coaching, the bifurcation of that also has been, we at RCF we have been doing mentoring. There's something called as woman tring that we've started, and of having a senior woman to who's a mentor to a junior woman who's newly come into the organization to carry the path ahead. So making them more comfortable.
Wonderful.
Something new that we have come up with.
Great.
Thank you very much.
You know, that alignment we talked about, the values, vision alignment, that also helps. The mentoring program will actually help when the alignment is clear. Mm-hmm. When you know that this is where it's going, then a mentoring program will actually help people to navigate from one point to the other as well. So it's clear that why the junior person is here, what they are aiming, and what the senior person needs to provide them. So it's very easy that way also.
It definitely clears the fog. It's very important to have someone senior tell me, what should I do? Even teach me a copy machine.
So it helps. Thank you, the complete team, Sachin and Ambika. Hope to get associated with you very soon. And thank you to all the participants for being a part of this webinar and for the patient listening. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We're really glad to give us this platform to share our thoughts. And it was a great opportunity for us to share this as well. In fact, this is a topic which we have talked a lot separately. As such, we keep talking about this topic, but in fact, we have first time done this as a formal presentation.
Okay. Yeah.
We've talked bits and pieces about this, the key elements of a learning culture, what a learning journey is, and the six core needs and all that. But such bringing this all together in this form was also an interesting for us as well.
For us also, because we do like 3-4 days programs on this, and to do it in 90 minutes was a challenge. But I think
getting us the crux was a challenge, but of course we got a good hold of it.
Yes, I'm very happy about it. Thank you so much for hosting us today. Yes, you guys have a great evening ahead.
Thank you.
Okay.